So good afternoon or morning, as the case may be, everyone. This is Alex Sagan. I am co-chair of the RESHET board of RAVSAK with Leslie Zafran, who's also on the call. And we work on this project with Dr. Dana Goldberg from the RAVSAK office. We are very excited to have Jonathan Cannon as a presenter today. Jonathan Cannon may be known to many of you as he was most recently a longtime head of the Charles E. Smith Jewish Day School in the greater Boston area, which is a large and in this world legendary school. Jonathan has actually been a school leader for 20 years, 12 of them at the Charles E. Smith School. And he is now consulting to schools on school governance issues and working with other nonprofits as well. And as I understand it, Jonathan's consulting practice is focusing on three key areas. That's coaching senior leaders in both educational and other nonprofit organizations, consulting on school change and helping schools to adapt to 21st century educational opportunities, and also providing keynote speaking and other professional development to support the implementation of new educational and organizational directions. So that should give you some idea of the themes that Jonathan will be hitting on today. As you know, he is going to be talking about how boards can support school change. And at this point, I'd like to turn it over to Jonathan to take us through his presentation, and we will have opportunities for questions. You should feel free to type them in, but there will also be times to unmute and speak up, and we hope that everyone will. Thanks a lot. Jonathan.
Alex, thanks very much indeed. Thanks also to Idana, to Eliza, for this invitation. As Alex said, long-time head of school in a RAVSAK school, actually. I think Charles E. Smith Jewish Day School was one of the early members of RAVSAK, and also we were very involved in the transition of the National Association of Jewish High Schools. I don't know if any of you would necessarily remember that, to become a part of RAVSAK. So it's always an honor to learn with people and from RAVSAK. And I thank you very much for this opportunity. And I tend to find I hope I can share some wisdom, but I end up learning a lot more for what I'm doing. So thanks in advance for that. I'm going to try and bring up a PowerPoint. I'm just still getting the hang of the technology. So you're either going to see a PowerPoint or you're going to see a picture of my children on vacation, which may yet be more interesting. Here we go. Let's try and get back to the beginning of that. Okay, I know a number of you are on mute. If anyone's not on mute or is able to type in, can you just let me know that it's visible and that I've done it what I'm supposed to do. Okay, I've got the message that it's visible. So thanks very much again. I want to split what we're doing into three sections. The first is really looking at some key aspects of school culture. We see school culture. Every one of you has a school. Every school is unique, and the way school culture operates fits in with a particular school. But there's some general points we can look at about school cultures, and also Jewish day school cultures have their own particular angle on that. So, want to have highlight some of the individual unusual aspects maybe of school culture, particularly because they impact how change takes place in the school community. The second is, and it'll probably be the briefest, is a look at change itself. And the reason that that'll be the briefest is not because it's not a major subject, but it really stands alone, looking at change, how change works, where it's effective, where it's not effective. We're all experiencing it, and I just want to give an overview of a couple of aspects of it. I don't want to even pretend that in this kind of presentation we can analyze all aspects of change and how it applies to school. And then maybe the third section we'll focus on again a little bit more, which is how boards can help support change, how schools can help boards support change, and look at some maybe some paradigms and some suggestions for your board. In between each of those sections, I'm going to stop for questions and answers. If it's okay with you, and since you can't respond to me, it is okay with you. What I'd like to do is to sort of run through each section and then stop with a break for questions and answers. That way we keep some fluidity. It may be that we don't get to all the questions and answers, maybe that we do, but if we don't, please know that I'm happy to either work directly with Idana and Liza to supply any answers that aren't being given so that you get them afterwards, or I can work directly with you, whatever you're most comfortable with. So that's just a little bit on structure. So I'm going to just do two very brief cultural analogies. I bank at PNC. I'm happy at PNC. Just as an experiment, a few weeks ago, I walked into my bank and I tried to get the person, the bank teller, the person behind the window to give me some secrets or some information about how morale is at the bank and whether they thought that the leadership was effective. And surprise, surprise, the person said to me, you know what, it's not something that we are allowed or it's appropriate for us to discuss. It isn't the way things, you know, they were very polite, but employees don't discuss things with a client or with somebody asking a question. And it's the reason I did the experiment is because it's not always the same in schools. There is a sense that it's more open and more of a free-for-all as to who can speak to who about what. And the second cultural analogy, which makes me smile because somebody suggested it to me. I wish I could have thought of it, but I didn't. Is, you know, imagine that one of your children or one of your relatives had got a opportunity to work at the Supreme Court for one of the justices, and you posted on Facebook, do you think that's a good justice, or would you suggest one of the others, and why not, and what experiences have you had with family clerking? You know, it just isn't going to happen. It don't work like that. And yet I've seen on Facebook, and I think some of you may have done as well, like a posting saying my kid is going to be in such and such a person's class, and could you possibly make any suggestions? Are they a good teacher? Should I try and shift to a different class, etc. So I just wanted to give those two introductory points. I'm going to now, if I get this right, show you a short video clip from an old commercial for the Guardian newspaper in the UK, because I think it's another piece that's illustrative of the reality, actually, of being on a board or being in a school. So hopefully this will come through. So I'm hoping I'm back on. I need to just get the PowerPoint back on again. Easier said than done.
No.
That's not it.
Great video for the Guardian there.
Thank you. Yeah, well, it's You know, it really does. In many ways, it sums up a lot of what it is, life leading a school, either board or professional leadership. You have a broader picture, and everybody comes at with their own perspective. One of the things I've learned, and I think it's important to leverage as school leadership or to recognize, is sometimes we expect people to see the whole picture, but that's not really fair. You know, I've learned instead of trying to persuade a parent who hasn't got something that they thought was very important, that, you know, they really need to see the whole picture. I think it's much sounder for me to actually suggest as a head of school, look, there is a whole picture. You know, your job is to represent your child's interest, which it is. I hear that. Sometimes there's a perspective that I have to take into account, and I want to share it with you. You know, sometimes there's an expectation that everybody is viewing it from the top down. But anyway, let's look at a piece of school culture. The real tight relationship is the teacher, the student, and the parent. Whether it should be or whether it shouldn't be, when I look at that, it seems to make sense. But what you can see is that the school administration exists somewhere outside of that circle. Very few people in the constituency see the school administration as essential, which has a lot of challenges on its own. I'm not saying it isn't. That's where, you know, I've come from most recently. But in terms of how people look out, the school administration is not part of the tight relationship. And the board is off to the other side, where, again, you know, you sometimes hear from them. Sometimes people think about them. Sometimes people comment on them. But again, not, you know, we might go to the board or the school administration with a issue. We might speak about the board or the school administration at the swimming pool, but they're not our everyday relationship is teacher, parent, student. And even though that looks obvious and it looks like how it should be, I'm not saying it shouldn't be like that, but it's actually quite unusual to have the management of the organization not integrated for most of the users of the organization into everyday life. Not that we typically experience management. When you walk into a bank, you don't know necessarily who the managers are, but you do have a sense that they're often integrated. So let's look at some realities of culture. How does this impact? So one of the biggest issues is everybody in a school culture has multiple, not everybody, most people have multiple connections. The amount of teachers who are parents is significant. I don't know why it happens so often, but a board member often tends to live next door to, sorry, that should say a poor performing teacher. My apologies. So, you know, where there's an issue going on between the school and between the teacher. And as luck would have it, if not next door neighbors, that teacher is very friendly or has a relationship with a number of board members, including maybe having taught one of the board members' children. And, that can make things very, very complicated. They're, you know, one hat and another hat. And we often say at the beginning of board meetings, you know, we need you to wear your board hat during this meeting. And we do need people to wear their board hat, but it's not all that easy and we can't always do it. We are wearing our parent hat. We are wearing our we know the person being talked about hat. And so it's complicated. Not saying that there's rights and wrongs. There are best practices here, but sometimes we just throw these things out. Oh yes, everyone has to wear their board hat at a board meeting, as if that's the easiest thing in the world and it's always going to happen. It isn't. And that's why best practice in selecting boards recommends that the majority of the board don't have another relationship with the school other than being a board member. And again, one of those things that it's beautiful to say, much more difficult on a realistic basis to implement, particularly in Jewish day schools. I put the next bullet because I've been working with a school where this is the scenario, and I don't envy the person this was. So the head of school is a parent in the school. On the weekends, this head of school is the part-time rabbi of the shul that 90% of the school students attend. As well as being the parent of a student, the head of school is also the wife of a teacher. So it's there's just too many hats to wear and so much input. And I'm not sure whether that would happen in multiple other schools apart from Jewish day schools. Not sure. The rabbi one may or may not. It probably won't exist in that. But this is the reality. and very, very complex. And you're going to see later that complex doesn't necessarily mean impossible. It means that it's that there's associated with it, and we have to understand what they are in order to be effective, as opposed to, again, what we sometimes do is just say it should be like this. We have to decide what it is like, and that's why I'm just running you through these realities. Confidentiality, particularly in Jewish day schools, has a slightly different meaning. Sometimes people say, I'm going to tell you something that is confidential, and you mustn't tell anyone, as it is confidential. So that's one approach to confidentiality. Another one is, yeah, didn't hear it from me, and then proceed to share whatever it is that you didn't hear. And then it's, I think you should know this, but don't say anything, as the head of school asked us not to discuss it with anyone. One of my earliest and most intriguing experiences, and I did learn a lot from it, was that there was, shortly after I'd started, there were some big changes taking place in school and personnel changes, and there were a lot of complicated communication issues, and many of them were coming to from our faculty to parents. And so I addressed a faculty meeting, and I spoke about the importance of faculty not sharing confidential information outside of the family. People are always welcome to come see me, but we need faculty to remember that they're employees of the school. And within about 5 minutes at the end of that meeting, the buzz from tens of parents was, can you believe Cannon met with the faculty and told them that they're not allowed to talk with the parents? Is he turning this place into some kind of South American dictatorship? And all I'd done was to ask people, and they'd immediately gone to the parents and said, you'll never guess what it is he told us to. He told us not to talk to the parents. So I learned over time that most people who work in schools follow exactly what you'd expect employees to do. It's difficult for some faculty, partly because they have a connection with the parents, partly because some of our parents are often trying to milk faculty for information. So as we'll see a bit later, instead of fighting it, I've learned a bit more to leverage it for the sake of good communication and good change. Let's look at these primary relationships very quickly and then take a break for questions and answers. The relationship between parent and teacher is paramount. That's the core relationship. What we don't always remember is who the primary client is in a school. It's the student. That's what everything exists for. That's why we do what we do. That's why we're all in the board positions that we're in, because we believe that students should have the best possible educational preparation, meaningful religious experiences at school. That's why we do it, and we need to keep reminding ourselves. If you were to look at a straightforward organization chart of a school, the person to whom a teacher reports is frequently less qualified than the missing word is the administrator. We often supervise people who are more qualified than we are to go into a classroom, to assess, but we've moved into that position, and that again has some complications and some opportunities in the relationship. Leave aside, there was a repaste of the confidentiality has a different meaning there. So let me stop for questions and answers. I don't know if anybody, thoughts, suggestions, Q&A. I think if you want to say it verbally, is it #6 that you press, or you can type it in and we'll try our best to answer it.
*6 if people want to unmute.
*6, there you go. We good?
No questions at this point?
Okay.
All right. Push on, Jonathan.
We'll push on. So I'm going to give you a little scenario, and then I'm going to test you out with a poll. And it's about your tolerance for change. It's not a judgmental question. It's really a question for you to think about. So a parent approaches you in your capacity as a board leader. She is frustrated because she has heard that a neighbor with 4 children her and her husband, that he managed to get tuition assistance from the school and is only paying 60% of tuition. I don't know why this is moving. He he laughingly explains how he, I don't know why it keeps moving, it's doing this on its own accord. He laughingly explains how he is able to use his cash business to avoid declaring half his income on his tax return. The parent who's speaking to you is furious and asks what you're going to do about it. You pass the information discreetly to the relevant people, and they are able to discern that this is in fact a case where the parent is avoiding paying. Sometimes we do look at cases and find that they're legitimate. Rather than having a legitimate excuse. The decision is made that the head of school will approach the family and ask them to pay or talk with them. The family is very aggressive and they decide to send out another school in the community, and that school agrees to give them the tuition assistance that your school doesn't want to give them. The family comes back to your school and threatens to leave with all four kids unless they continue to receive the discount. No, it's now a discount. It's not tuition assistance. You believe, oh, what have I done here? You believe that they will leave if you don't, I don't know what this has done. You believe that they will leave if you don't give them the discount. So you're fairly sure that all four children will leave. You also know that the parent who came to you initially will not leave. That person is committed to the school, will be disappointed, and will say to you, you know, I wish you'd done something else, but they're part of the school community. I do apologize, I've uploaded the wrong one, but I'm not going to try and change it now, which is why these typos are still there. You've got to upload a PowerPoint, then you have to start it. I've just uploaded the wrong one, so please accept my apologies for the number of typos. My question to you, the enrollment in the school is very fragile at the moment. School finances are very fragile at the moment. You're concerned about losing students. You're concerned about losing income. So I'm going to put a little poll up, and I'm going to ask you, what action would you take under those circumstances? It's going to come over as percentages. It's not going to come over as anything more than that. And here it is. Let's just give you a minute to click on one of them, and let's see what comes up. No, you can't get out of this, folks. So if you haven't voted, are you saying you can't see the poll, Alex?
Yes, that's correct, Jonathan.
Okay. I've got a thing on my screen saying it's in progress. So I'll just have to tell you the results. I'm not sure how to make the poll visible, but are you able to click? Is there an option?
I don't see it, but it's all right. I mean, I don't need to vote as long as you're getting some data from other people.
Yeah. Okay. So, roughly, just to give you a sense, do nothing is zero. And my PowerPoint is moving on its own, by the way. Do nothing is zero, and ask the family to leave if they don't pay up is two-thirds of you who voted, and explain the issue to the family and do nothing is a third of the people who voted. So it's kind of two-thirds against a third there. As I said, I'm not here to judge at all, I ask you the question because it's not a complicated philosophical question. If I'd have said to you, ideally, what would you do? I think the answers would have all been fairly unanimous. But change is not fully about ideally what you would do. It's a combination of ideally what you would do and pragmatically what are you able to do. And so this is a question about, in some ways, your tolerance for change. But also I want to highlight for you, I'm not going to give you an answer because there isn't one. We all know what the answer is, but what we would do in reality, there isn't a clear answer. Each of you are deciding that with your school. I guess what I want to take you to from here is to show you that schools need to change. There's really no question about it. We don't have the luxury, and that's we can talk about another time. We don't have the luxury of sitting still. But how we do it and the speed that we do it and the impact that it might have on families who are within the school and students primarily who are within the school, it is going to vary. And if we're asking a board to support it, a board has to look at, and we have to look at, the board's tolerance, comfort zone, and all of those kinds of things. And so that was the point of that exercise. I'm going to just use this. There's really a Pat Bassett, who was for many years the head of the National Association of Independent Schools. He wrote, he summarized three ways of change that happen in schools. And I just want to run through them with you. I'm going to talk about my preference, but let's just run through them. So the first is diktat. The head of school or the president of the board, or hopefully it's the head of school, hopefully it's nobody actually, but, this is how we're going to do it, period. And there are times when that makes a lot of sense. But for fundamental change, if the leader of the school just says, this is how we're going to do it, there will be some level of accomplishment. I mean, something will happen. There'll be no ownership. It's very unlikely that the community will have come along with the leader. And the change, and this is important, typically does not outlast the leader, because the change was about the person who suggested it, or the person who required it, not about the change itself. It doesn't always outlast the leader. There are actually times when a change by diktat is determined to be the only way of getting a change that's good to actually happen. And then the change becomes part of the community, and the community accepts it. But very often the change does not outlast the leader, certainly not in the form that the leader presents it. I know from, again, working with a school, and also from my own experiences, that often when you do a change when you do a change by diktat, you then need to stop and start again. In the school I was working at, Charles E. Smith, we tried, and it was really important for us to have one-to-one computing. It really fitted with the direction we were going. We clearly went about it initially the wrong way. We did it by what I would call diktat. There was a lot of reaction against it by different constituencies in the school. We started again and did it in a different way, and the change has been enormous. It fits, it works, the parents are comfortable with it. Most importantly, the students and the faculty are comfortable with it. Another way of leading change is by consensus. As Pat Bassett will say, consensus is diametrically opposed to Jewish ideology. It's difficult in a day school. It can take a minimum of several centuries. We can have death by meeting, which means that we're rehashing and rehashing and rehashing. The real issue about consensus, it can be derailed by one objection. If you've set yourself the goal of everybody agreeing with something, then if any single person doesn't agree, you don't have consensus. Now, there's times when consensus are very, very valuable. For example, if you're having a search for a new head of school, or if you're looking to pass a controversial or complicated budget, if you can build consensus and present that the board is behind this, or the search committee is behind this 100%, that is very powerful. So I'm a little unfair on consensus. What I'm saying is that it can't be the model of decision making, because it's going to be derailed at some point or another. His third method, which is, none of this should be shocking to anybody, is called progressive buy-in. There's a little graphic there, which I think the letters might be too small, but it's not essential. You kind of read it as we're going along. The key for progressive buy-in, and this is where most schools make a mistake, is they don't clearly communicate the outcome and the expected outcome and the deadline. So the whole point about progressive buy-in is that you're giving time for the community to learn about it, to buy in, to comment on it, but you've set the expectation already. Let me give you an example of a school who are currently working, maybe they should have done a long time ago, to have dynamic websites. Every single teacher has to have a website, not just a flat one, but one where things are happening. And what they've said to the school is by a certain time, those websites have to be up. Now you can work at your own pace. We can help you during that time. They've communicated to the parents that that's when it'll be. So parents aren't expecting it yet. Then if you look down what's happened here, the school is supporting the pioneers. So it said, who wants to start this process? And it's put resources and time behind that group. It's using peer-to-peer professional development. One of the most effective models of professional development in schools is peer-to-peer. You'll often hear from teachers that we bring in the most fantastic, energizing and fabulous experts, and then they go and there's nothing left. You know, I've got the I've worked with a number of schools, but one of the ones which I'm most excited about is that instead of bringing me in once, I'm working with them on an ongoing basis. And we're having, you know, we're doing ongoing professional development. And really my job isn't to do the professional development. It's to help them professionally develop one another. There also has to be aggressive mentoring, supervision, and evaluation for progressive buy-in. We have to really be helping the teachers, mentoring them, but also we have to be holding people to expectations. And then the last part, which we could talk more about on another occasion or leave you to think about, is leverage primary relationships for progressive buy-in. So one of the things we always worry about is that when we're making a potential change within a school, is it going to affect morale? Are the teachers going to say something to the parents? One of the things we can really do is leverage that relationship between teachers and parents. You know, sometimes, and I'm sure you've heard from many parents, the school sends out too many emails and we don't know which ones to read and we don't know which ones not to read. You never hear that about a parent from their child's teacher. They sent out an email every 20 minutes, the parent would be thrilled. Use that vehicle. Ask the teachers to help sell or to help explain something that the school is doing, an initiative that's going on in the school. Sometimes, you know, let the teachers get excited, parents, but even some, you know, if you've got a really important announcement, something you really want the parents to be at, like a science evening that's going to explain the new science curriculum, as well as writing out to all the parents, or instead of writing out to all the parents, ask the teachers to include information about it in whatever they send home. And also, why it all links together is you've got to have mentoring, supervision, evaluation. There has to be consistency, not in the words that go out, but in the kinds of communication that go out from different teachers. You don't want a situation where one parent feels that they're lacking information because their teacher doesn't bother to send it out. So these things all begin to come together. One more video to show you, give you a little bit of a thought as to how we sometimes get hung up by change, and then it's back to questions and answers. So while this video is going on, you might want to think if you've got any questions or answers, or if you'd like to type them in while the video is going, then by all means. But we're going to take a pause at the end of the video, assuming I can get this to work again. So the video should start any second. Okay. So I don't know how much that needs to go into great detail, but one of the biggest challenges that we do have with change is that we get stuck in the middle. I don't think I have to say more. The key again, and this is what I do want to say, is instead of taking change purely incrementally, it has to be incremental, make sure that the outcome, that where we're headed, has been articulated clearly to all of the constituencies, then there's a huge amount of flexibility as to how we do it. If, on the other hand, we don't articulate an end point and we just do it from the bottom up, then we're going to end up with this broken escalator, whereas with any point it can stop. And if the person obviously looked up, they'd see they could walk up five steps and they'll be there, but nobody could see the top of the escalator. Q&A. Again, it's star six if you want to...
Jonathan?
Yeah.
Jonathan, it's Leslie. Hi.
Hi.
So, a question. I love the idea of actually leveraging that relationship, which, as you were speaking about earlier, can sometimes, you know, really go awry, but here you're using it for very constructive purposes. But I'm wondering how... So I could imagine the board could suggest this as an idea, but does the board have a place in this? I mean, I realize we're outside that sort of Venn diagram that you drew, but is there some way for the board to be doing some part of this? I feel as though right now we're talking about everyone other than what we could perhaps do as in our roles.
Sure. I mean, it's a great question. We'll come to it a little bit in a sec, but I think there's something to be said. No, but there's something to be said here, which is that the board are essentially primary in this role. One of the things that we don't, as schools, talk about enough is being proactive in telling a story. We're often, and boards are often, very reactive. So we hear a concern or we hear a complaint, and then we explain it. So we're already halfway down before we've started climbing. Now, really, the role of boards and the role of professional leadership, you know, one of the things we don't do as professional leaders enough is to provide board members with the bullet points to go out and be proactive. So, for example, if we're making a change to one-on-one computing, we don't just want to put them, as professional leaders, we don't want to put the board in a position where we let you know we're doing it, and we let you know it could be quite controversial, and we let you know, we say to you, but it's really important, then people start complaining about it, and you're already on the defensive. What we really want everybody in the school to be doing is be, not the offensive, that's the wrong word, but you should have your bullets, and you should be telling your story before the process even begins. So from the moment the first letter goes out about it, board members, are, you know, it's much more important for schools to really have these proactive conversations and these tone setting conversations. There's a book that some of you may have read, some of you may not. It's called, and I will send out the information, it's called Raving Fans. And it's about the story of the Washington Redskins, which if I'd lived here longer would probably be very dear to my heart. But the gist of it is how can a team that does so badly have such a huge following? Why does every game sell out, irrespective of how the team does? And it's really about positive conversation and about creating an image. So we can talk more about that later in a different time. But that you're at the border at the front and center of this.
Thank you. That's great.
Any other questions at this point? Okay, so let me run us through the next few minutes, which is where the board fit in with all of this. And then hopefully, if I do this quickly, what I'll try and do is keep this pretty quick so that you can ask generally about the, you know, if I leave something out, then it's an opportunity to ask a question rather than me talk too much.
And we've got about 15 minutes overall, Jonathan.
Okay, so I'm going to try and do this in about 5 minutes. And Alex, if I'm going over, just say, you know, can you wrap it up for questions? And I won't be offended.
Great. Okay. Thanks.
Okay. So And there's other places to go into huge detail about this. There really has to be, in order for change to be effective, a very functioning head of school support evaluation process in the school. There has to be a small group working with the head. The group has to be confidential, and I mean confidential as in confidential, the real thing this time. It has to meet frequently. It's not a once a year evaluative meeting. It's a conversation that takes place. It's support and evaluation. That group then has to demonstrate assertive board leadership. What does it mean, assertive board leadership? It means that that group is representing the issues that come up in the meetings or the outcomes to the board, and is representing the concerns of the board back to the head of school if that's appropriate. But this next bit is critical. You have to have established methodologies for funneling feedback to school leadership. One of the things that can really cause challenges in change is when, you know, board members are phoning up the head of school the whole time and saying, I was at a bat mitzvah, I heard this, I want to feed it back, I need to get back to the parent, you know, could you let me know what's going on? And you have multiple different conversations going on. There has to be a system, whether it's if a board member feeds it back to the board president runs through them in the weekly meeting with the head of school, or whichever way it is, for change to, because we can't have multiple different inputs, and where we do, the head of school has to be empowered to say, you know what, let's get all those concerns together, let's funnel them in this direction. A well-meaning head of school and a well-meaning president want to, and I understand that, feedback, be responsive to issues as they come up. It really is difficult during periods of change because it creates a stop-start. You know, it doesn't allow us to get from point A to point B without always reflecting on the bit in the middle as a whole school. Board members have to be able to say to parents, and that's why the outcome, having the outcome clearly articulated, is so important. Board members have to be able to say, this is where we're headed. We're going through a process. There's going to be bumps along the road, and I will certainly feedback this bump. The important thing is we keep our eye on the goal. So that's a critical piece, is head of school support and evaluation. Then I'd say leadership training, board training. Neither head nor board is an expert, a full expert in school organizational development. Typically, the head of school has come up from an educational role into an educational leadership role, and our best expertise is instructional leadership, is moving the school forward educationally. Change management is a beast all of its own, and we need to make sure that our heads are given the maximum support they can get. And there's a number of different courses in the community or outside the community that work in school change management. Likewise, the board may well have expertise in organizational development, but as you can see from the first part of this presentation, don't necessarily have expertise in school organizational development and growth. They're two different things, and we can't necessarily bring one mindset fully into the other. The second is connected, invest in training, the various people involved, the faculty, the board, the leadership, and to an extent the parents can benefit from training. Alongside that, put professional development programs in the school, not just about content areas, but about process. How are we going to get from A to B? So part of professional development can be about process and coaching. I think it's not just a plug, obviously, it's the work I do. I do the work because the single strongest professional development input I ever had was the coach who worked with me for 5 or 6 years. That person was able to advise me, guide me, hold me accountable, and help me be the best person that I could possibly be. Coach is different to a mentor. Coach isn't somebody you just phone up whenever you're feeling depressed and say, I'm feeling depressed. And the coach says, so you're feeling depressed. The mentor says, so you're feeling depressed, are you? And, you know, shares that they had the same problem. That's not coaching. Coaching is holding you to standards, helping you be effective. And there, you know, that helps you with your leadership plan, which I'm not going to talk about. But again, we need to hold our professional leaders to consistent outcomes, and those outcomes need to be transparent. Let's look at the last, which is protecting leadership. We have to accept that change is painful. We can't say to our school professionals, I want you to turn over half the faculty or a third or 25% of the faculty, or make sure that we only have quality faculty in the school, but I don't want to hear about it. You've got to be able to see the whole picture. And in fact, the board should really, and that's the responsibility of the professionals, the board should really be discussing what might be, even if not by name, what might be some of the fallout from a change decision that's been made. Going back to our tolerance for change, if we decide to be very aggressive about tuition assistance and who should get it and who shouldn't, what are the consequences going to be of that, and how is the school going to handle that? Personnel changes always are, you know, they need there needs to be, even if the board hasn't been told, sometimes the board will say to me, you should have told me this information, then I would have been in a better position. That's true. But even when you haven't, if there's a personnel change in the school and you haven't got a clue where it's come from, still have to be able to be confident saying this leader is moving us forward, moving us to change. Unhappy teachers' constituent opinions speak for themselves. We're doing two things if you look at the last two slides, holding the leadership accountable and supporting them through the process. In order to do that, need to have discussed the process. And that hopefully might have been just over 5 minutes. Let me just throw it open for thoughts, discussions. That's my bit of the presentation.
Thank you, Jonathan. So the floor is open for questions, examples you'd like to share. I'd like Jonathan to elaborate on anything. Plus it's *6 to unmute. Or if you're using your microphone, I think you could just click on yourself.
While other people are thinking, this is Leslie again. Jonathan, can you talk a little bit more on that last slide regarding protecting leadership, what you meant by constituent opinions? Can you just talk a bit more about that?
Sure. So obviously in a school, there's going to be multiple constituent opinions, and that's how it should be. And it really plays back, I think, to a previous slide, which is that we do need to find ways to channel this as much as possible. It's, as you know, because you all have one around your heads of school, are particularly, they're very challenging jobs. We do have a responsibility, and it goes both ways, that sometimes we diminish the importance of constituent opinions. You know, I'll say things like, well, one person thought this and another one thought the precise opposite, therefore they negate one another. Well, they don't actually. They're two very valid opposing constituent opinions. What we don't want is for the head of school to every single day be going backwards and forwards. What I mean, I would suggest is that schools have very rigorous annual surveys, and I think those surveys should invite people's opinions on the broader issues of the school, but also how their students are experiencing education, role of faculty in the school, role of administrators in the school. We should put ourselves out there to be accountable. At the same time, we can't stop every time a constituent opinion says, I think you should have done it that way, or I think you should have done it the other way. So I guess there's a message coming the whole way through here. Schools need to be more accountable than they are, as in the professional leadership, but we need to do it through structured venues. That makes sense?
Yes, that's great. Thank you.
Hi, I just had one quick question. It's Shira Brown from Buffalo. I was just wondering if you could make a global comment. In an institution where a fair amount of change is necessary and planned for, could you make some sort of give us some pearls regarding where sort of holding accountable ends and micromanaging begins?
Well, the pearl of wisdom is it doesn't. They slide into each other beautifully. But the most effective thing I suggestion I can make is to have a very again a very well structured and committed leadership head of school. I'm not sure how the leadership works. Evaluation process. Set clear goals with the school leadership. If you're concerned about how that school leadership is performing, break down the goals and set them so that they could be, some of them could be 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, and then evaluate the progress against the goals that have been set. Once it becomes, and I'll give you an example and say, where it becomes micromanagement is if all along that way, somebody's saying, why did you do it that way and why didn't you do it this way? So you really need to keep an eye on the goals. Where are we meant to be heading? So if it's a small management thing and, you know, and you want the head of school to have, you know, greater buy-in professionally, then that's the goal that you set the head of school. You say, I want, you know, we want the leadership in the school to be more fully owning what it is. We don't say to the head of the school, we want you to have the following four people on a committee for the school leadership. You're not speaking often enough to the lower school principal. If the lower school principal's told you that, the answer should be go and speak to the head of school. And then if the head of school's unable to deliver on his or her goals, then that's a separate discussion about the future of the head of school. But you do need to be setting goals with measurable outcomes and then measuring them at certain periods. It's that here's the expected goal, here's the expected outcome, and then here's how we want you to do it. It's the here's how we want you to do it, which becomes, I think, micromanaging. Does that answer the question?
Yes, very well. Thank you.
Any other questions? Jonathan, I like the way you put this, Alex. I like the way you put this together very much. I mean, in a sense, correct me if I'm wrong, it seems as if you're saying that the main driver of change, in a sense, is the executive, is the head of school. Mm-hmm. And that what the board needs to do is actually make sure that it really effectively supports and in effect manages that the head of school. Around goal setting and around accountability. And then the board's role with the broader constituents is really to be on message, to be ambassadors, mm-hmm. to make sure that they're there to make the case, to support the head, to support the changes, and to not allow there to be any daylight between what the head of school is doing and what the board is saying about it.
Yeah. I think that's right. Yeah. Sorry, go on, Alex.
Yeah, no, I was
just,
go ahead.
No, I think sound right? That sounds absolutely right. And that last piece about the board being ambassadors, you know, it reminds me of something I started with earlier and wanted to just come back to. Maybe it's a good, as we sort of wrap up type concept. This business of being proactive is absolutely critical. And one of the things, I don't know how many of you are involved in fundraising, but hopefully all of you, but one of the things we often forget to do, certainly as lead professionals in a school, is the ask. You know, I'll sit with a fundraiser, I'll get them very excited about the school, and then forget or not feel comfortable saying, I would like you to give us a gift of such and such in order to help realize this vision. That, but you know, I sometimes, when I started, you think, well, if I really sell the school beautifully, then that person's going to say, that's fantastic, Jonathan, you know, here's a gift. I really love what it is that you're doing. We can also make asks of board members, of parents, of teachers to help us get people excited about the school. People want to help, but don't often know how to. I gathered a group of parents, in a couple of years before I left on a particular issue, which was the issue of managing. It was to do with art in the lower school. Some of it was complicated details, and there was about 3/4 of the parents really liked what we were doing, which was having the art expert go into the classes and train teachers to be more effective and not just teaching the students outside of the classroom. 25% didn't. So I sat down with a group of parents who really were into it and said, you know what, I appreciate you telling me that, but I want you to do two things. Not just the first one is obvious, which is to respond when people say to you, you know, it's not a good idea, explain why it is a good idea. But more important, I'm asking you to go and find people and start a conversation about why you're excited about this change that the school is making. And I think it's a question, it's something for the board to do as well. You know, we sit down there and one of the things we ask them to do is support the head of school, support the president of the board, support this idea. But let's ask them, let's say, please find people, go and look for people to have this conversation with. Many, many schools, we don't own the conversation. The conversation is owned by a group of people who have negative thoughts, and we respond to that conversation. It is amazing how if we ask a group of people to go out and get excited, it flips and the conversation begins to get owned by the school. The corollary and the tough bit of that, and I said to you as board and board leaders, is there has to be very little space for board members who are breaking confidentiality or who are involving themselves in negative thought, publicly negative thoughts about the school. I got to close.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you so much for this rich presentation. Would it be possible to make the slides available to people in the listserv?
Sure. I'm going to make sure you get the ones with the right typos on it, wrong typos. But
so thank you for sharing your time and your wisdom. Thank you to everyone who participated on the call. I just want to remind everyone that we have another webinar. It's with Dr. Mark Kramer, the executive director of RAVSAK. He's going to be sharing some of the data from the survey of school leadership that RAVSAK has been conducting recently. And that's on Thursday, May 22nd, in this same time slot. So be sure to register, and we hope you'll participate.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you again.
Thank you, Jonathan.
All right. Bye, all.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.